So I made this whole series of videos on how to build this 8-bit computer. But in this video, I want to get a bit philosophical and ask the question, is this thing really a computer? And if not, why not? What's it missing? And obviously, even if this thing is a computer, it's a very limited computer, right? I mean, our clock is incredibly slow. We can speed it up a bit, but even then, you know, the maximum clock speed, at least with the components I'm using, looks to be about 300 hertz here, which, you know, if I compare that to the computer I'm using to edit this video, that's got 2.8 gigahertz, so it's almost 10 million times faster. But that's not the point, right? You know, sure, this is limited. And in fact, the memory, you know, instead of 16 gigabytes, we only have 16 bytes, right? Because we had a 4-bit address. But I'm not asking, is this a limited computer? I'm asking something a little bit more philosophical, which is this thing a computer at all? So to answer that, I think we've got to look at two things. So one is, you know, what is this thing currently capable of? And then second, like, what should a computer be able to do? And are we missing anything? So, you know, these are the instructions we've got so far, and there's a bunch of stuff in here, load A, store A, add, subtract. But one thing, just as an example, you know, what about multiplying? You know, we don't have an instruction to do that. So that, and that certainly seems like something that a computer ought to be able to do is multiply two numbers, right? So okay, maybe we need to add a multiply instruction next. So, you know, we could do that by adding some additional hardware like we did for subtract and add. So we've got adder and subtractor here. Maybe we could build some hardware to multiply two numbers. And you can do that. You know, it's just combinational logic to look at what's in this register and what's in this register, multiply those together, put the result into the result register here. And then we need to add some sort of control signal here, add another bit to our control word for multiplication, and then, you know, put the appropriate thing in the microcode and add another instruction. So we could do that, and then the computer would be able to multiply. But multiplication isn't the only thing that's missing here. I mean, what about division? What about exponentiation? What about logarithms, trigonometric functions? I mean, we could go on and on with all the functions that we're missing. But if we just keep adding new instructions for each new function that we think up, you know, we're going to be adding instructions all day, and we're going to be building, you know, custom hardware for each instruction. Is that really what we want? Yeah, I would think that a computer, what we'd want is we'd want enough instructions to be able to program the computer to do any of those functions. So we ought to be able to write a program that can multiply. You know, we've got an add instruction, and multiplication is just a bunch of addition. So it seems like we ought to be able to write a program that just takes two numbers, you know, perhaps they're in memory somewhere before the program starts, and then run through that program, and it would multiply those two numbers and output the result to the display here. But it turns out that with the instructions that we've got here, it's impossible to write a program that does that. And I would encourage you, you know, give it a try. Look at these instructions, see if you can write a program, but I don't think it's possible. Which brings up this really interesting question, which is, what instructions do we need? And I don't just mean, well, if we had a multiply instruction, we'd be able to multiply. You know, I mean, what would be the minimum set of instructions we would need to let us write programs that would let us do any of these operations? And not just any of these operations, but any operation. Though even that, like, is that really what we want? Do we just want to be able to do any operation, or do we really want enough instructions to be able to do any calculation, which might involve lots of different operations? Well, I don't know. It seems like maybe real computers are able to do more than just calculate things. So maybe what we really want is enough instructions to be able to do anything computable. But what does that even mean? You know, what exactly is computable and what isn't? I mean, we don't really expect a computer to be able to compute the meaning of life, right? So maybe what we're after is things that can be computed with an algorithm of some sort. But even that just raises questions about what kinds of operations the algorithm can do, and we're right back where we started. Though intuitively, we all kind of know what sorts of things a computer can and can't do, so, you know, maybe you know a computable problem when you see it. But without a rigorous definition of the set of computable problems, you know, how are we ever going to know if we've got all the instructions we need in order to compute anything? So this question of what you need in order to compute anything, and, you know, what does that even mean, this came up pretty early in the development of computer science. Alan Turing is widely regarded as the father of modern computer science, and, you know, one of the reasons is that in 1936 he wrote a paper that talked about this very question, and this is a copy of that paper, and in here he makes this astonishing claim, which is that it is possible to invent a single machine which can be used to compute any computable sequence. Now, it's not clear what he means by any computable sequence, but he does talk about the machine in quite a bit of detail. Well, he described this hypothetical machine that actually seems relatively simple. So it reads its input from a paper tape that is infinitely long, which is one of the reasons why it's only a hypothetical machine. But this tape is infinitely long in both directions, and it has a bunch of squares on it. And each of the squares contains a symbol, and the, the simplest case that it works is you can have two symbols. So either a space is blank, or maybe it has the symbol one. And every point on this tape has one of these symbols, either blank or a one. And then there is a head that can move back and forth along the tape, and it can look at just one symbol at a time. And then after looking at that symbol, it consults a table of instructions that might look something like this. And the table of instructions tells it what to do based on the state it's in and what symbol it scans. And so the machine also has a notion of a state. So it might be in state A, for example. And so if we're in state A and the head is pointed to a 1, then this is the line that we would look at in the table. And so then what it does is it writes a symbol 1 to the tape. So in the same position, it writes a 1. In this case, there's already a 1 there. But if it were blank, then it might write a 1 there. And then it moves to the left. So it moves to the left. And it could be the head that moves. It could be the tape that moves. It really doesn't matter, as long as you're consistent. And then it changes state to state C. And so now it's in state C, which means now when it looks at the table, it's looking just at these things that are in state C. And in this case, it's a 1. So it would erase the symbol there, move to the left, and then switch to state B. And it just keeps doing this until it finds its way to a transition to where it halts. It may or may not actually ever get there, but if it gets there, it halts. And then once it's halted, then whatever answer, whatever it's trying to compute would be on the tape somewhere that you could then look at. And so it turns out that with an appropriate table of instructions like this and some input, encoded on the tape before the machine starts, then this machine, a machine like this, can carry out pretty much any mathematical task. You just have to set up the right table of instructions. And in fact, it actually gets better than that. This universal computing machine that Turing talks about is just another machine like this that has a table of instructions that lets it basically start with a tape that has a different machine's table of instructions encoded on it. So that's the machine is supplied with a tape on the beginning of which is written this is a standard definition, which he defines up here, sort of reducing this table of instructions down to just sort of a number that you can put on the tape of some other computing machine. And then the universal machine can actually compute the same result that other machine would compute. So in other words, this universal machine can actually simulate itself or simulate any other machine like this. And so that's what leads Turing to this bold claim that it's possible to invent a single machine which can be used to compute any computable sequence. But this still leads us back to the same question of what do we mean by anything computable? What is this, any computable sequence? Well, even Turing admits that there really isn't a good answer to this. So later on in the paper here, he says, all arguments which can be given are bound to be fundamentally appeals to intuition, and for this reason, rather unsatisfactory mathematically. So he's pretty honest that there really isn't any good definition of exactly everything that a general purpose computer ought to be able to do. But he does do his best anyway to kind of argue that his universal machine that he's come up with can do everything it needs to. But, he says here the arguments are kind of a direct appeal to intuition or, proving that it's equivalent to some other definition in case, you like the other one better. Failing that, he gives a bunch of examples of different things that he can compute with this. But ultimately, it's not a super satisfying answer to what does it mean that you can compute anything that's computable. Now, at about the same time in 1936, there was this other guy, Alonzo Church, who was trying to figure that same thing out. And so he wrote this paper, which says, the purpose of this paper is to propose a definition of effective calculability, which is thought to correspond satisfactorily to the somewhat vague intuitive notion in terms of which problems this class are often stated. So he's trying to nail down an actual definition of what is this idea of everything that can be calculated. But the interesting thing is he comes at it from a completely different direction. So in this paper, he comes up with this whole new system of mathematics called Lambda Calculus, which starts with just a few rules. And this is really it. You've got variables, and then you've got the ability to define a function. So you can say a function that takes a variable x and returns some other expression. And again, that other expression has got to come from this list or be built from this. And then you have the ability to apply a function. So you can give a function and give it some parameter. And from this, he's able to argue that you can build on this to calculate anything calculable. Again, whatever that means. And, when I say you can build anything on just these rules, I mean it. So see how there aren't any numbers here? So, you know, when you're defining a function here, all you have is these abstract variables. You don't have numbers, you don't have Boolean values, you don't have anything to work with. You have to define all of that. And so here on page 3 of his paper, he's actually defining, you know, here's some abbreviations for the numbers 1, 2, 3, and so on. So this is a very fundamental, very abstract way of describing computing, which is pretty wild stuff and would be the topic of a whole other series of videos. But the reason that I bring Church up is that the invention of Lambda Calculus was actually just a tool in this paper to get to his real conclusion, which was also to show that not every problem of this class is solvable. So of these computable problems, not everything that's computable can actually be solved. And again, I won't go into the details of what that means, but the point is that at the time, this was an open question that no one actually knew the answer to, which is why this paper was so important. But what's really remarkable is that this question, which is also known as the decision problem, or more commonly at the time in German, it was known as the Entscheidungs problem, which I'm probably horribly butchering, was simultaneously answered by Turing's paper. And both of these were published in 1936. And so Turing and Church independently solved this unsolved problem at the same time, not knowing about each other's work. And they did it in completely different ways, which is pretty remarkable, because I think anytime you can solve the same underlying problem using two completely different methods that at first don't seem related, you know, it suggests that there might be some, you know, deeper, more fundamental connection between these things. And indeed, as soon as Turing heard about Church's work, he added this appendix to his paper. In August 1936, he added this appendix where he basically proves that everything that Lambda calculus can do, so effective calculability, is basically the same as computability. So everything that Lambda calculus can calculate is something that his machine can compute. And the converse, everything his machine can compute is something that can be calculated with Lambda calculus. And Church also came to the same conclusion and actually introduced the term Turing machine, which is now what we call, what Turing was originally calling the automatic machine. So in other words, a Turing machine can completely simulate Lambda calculus, and Lambda calculus can completely simulate a Turing machine. They are computationally equivalent. And so all of this comes back to this question of what do we mean by computability? You know, what is anything computable? What is anything calculable? Well, it's still this kind of squishy, intuitive, you know it when you see it kind of thing. But with Turing machines and Lambda calculus being these very different things that turn out to be identical in terms of precisely what they can compute, perhaps there is a single definition of computability. And so the result is that there's this widely accepted thesis, the Church-Turing thesis, that says that, you know, when we say that something is computable, that means it's computable by a Turing machine. So an algorithm is defined as anything that can be computed on a Turing machine, and that's it, no more, no less. So if we want to make sure our computer is truly flexible enough to be programmed to do pretty much anything, you know, as long as we make sure it can do anything a Turing machine can do, then we'll know that we can program it to compute anything computable. So even though, you know, we can't write a program now to multiply two numbers, if we just ignore that for a moment and just focus on, you know, making sure the computer can do everything a Turing machine can do, you know, when we're done with that, then we'll know that we'll be able to write a program to do multiplication, since, you know, surely multiplication is something that can be computed. And not just multiplication, you know, all of the amazing things that modern computers do are based on just this ability to compute any computable function. You know, the brightness of this red pixel here is really just the computation of a complex function with a bunch of different inputs that are constantly changing and being recomputed. So if we go back to the instruction set for a computer, you know, when we started, we were trying to figure out why we can't just use this add instruction somehow to write a program to multiply two numbers. And, you know, the problem is that our instruction set doesn't let us do everything a Turing machine can do. So let's figure out what's missing. If we think about what a Turing machine can do, a Turing machine has a tape that can move, you know, left or right one position at a time and read or write the data at that position. So, well, we've got RAM, we've got a load A, we've got a store A command, and, you know, RAM is random access, so we can read or write any position whenever we want. So that's certainly at least as powerful as a Turing machine in terms of being able to read and write data from the, well, in our case, the RAM, but in the Turing machine's case, the tape. But the other thing a Turing machine can do is that after reading a cell, it can take a different action. So if the cell is blank, it can move right. If the cell is a one, it can move left. So it can take a different action based on what it reads. And we can't actually do that. None of the instructions that we have actually does anything different based on the result of any data read from anywhere. So one thing that would give us that is a conditional jump instruction. So something just like the jump instruction that we've already got that skips to another instruction, but that only jumps sometimes based on some data value. So for example, we have this program here. If we load some data from address 14 and we subtract some other data that's in address 15, we might have this conditional jump instruction that conditionally jumps if the result of the subtraction is negative. So in other words, if the second value that we load is bigger than the first value. In that case, it jumps down to line 6 here, and it does some stuff down here. Otherwise, if the result of the subtraction is not negative, so the second value here is not bigger than the first value, then this conditional jump instruction just doesn't do anything at all, and execution just continues, and we do this other stuff here. And then once we're done doing that other stuff, we might have a jump instruction that then jumps us past this block and continues execution down here. So this is basically kind of the same thing as a if-then-else kind of thing. So you might almost imagine it looking like this in a different language. So you could say like if some value in memory address 14 minus memory address value in 15 is less than zero. So we're loading 14, 15, subtracting that. If that's less than zero, then we do some stuff. So that's this stuff here. Otherwise, we do some other stuff, which is this stuff here. And maybe it seems weird to have this instruction that says jump if the result of the previous subtraction is less than zero. That's kind of a weird thing. But it actually really doesn't matter what the conditional jump is actually looking at. As long as we're able to take some kind of different action based on something discernible in memory, that's enough to do what a Turing machine is doing. So just by adding one new instruction, our computer will be Turing complete, which means it can do anything a Turing machine can do, which means it can compute anything computable, which is an awful lot. So in the next video, I'll build the hardware for conditional jumps so we can actually turn this thing into a real computer. And I'll also actually write that program to multiply two numbers just to show that it's possible once it's Turing complete. You may want to try writing that program yourself while you're waiting, and maybe also think about what sort of conditional jump instruction you would add, because there's lots of different potential types of conditional jumps we could add. It doesn't really matter which one we add, but you may want to think about that and think about how you'd write a program to multiply. Now, there's one other thing that you might be wondering. You may remember me mentioning that a Turing machine uses this infinitely long tape, and you might be wondering how we're going to be able to do everything a Turing machine can do with only 16 bytes of memory. Well, you got me on that one. That's definitely a limitation. So in practice, this will never truly be equivalent to a Turing machine, because it will never have infinite memory. But hey, neither is any computer. And since 16 bytes of memory is not much further from infinity than 16 gigabytes of memory, I say we'll be close enough.